नमः श्री यतिराजाय विवेकानंद सूरये सच्चित् सुख स्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयो श्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः। Dear devotees and friends, I am extremely happy to meet you all online, virtually. Actually, would have been better, but anyway, something is better than nothing. At the outset, I am thankful to Swami Kripavayananda for inviting me to talk on managing time or a spiritual life as a part of the annual retreat of Toronto Center. When we talk about time management, most important thing is we must remember it is basically setting up of priorities of life. Most important thing in time management is setting up the priority of life. We do not get time for spiritual practice only because we do not give a priority to our spiritual practice. There's a beautiful example given in the book, The Seven Habits of Effective People by Stephen Covey. The seventh habit is sharpening the saw. Example is given, a woodcutter was cutting the wood and the saw with which he was cutting the wood had already been, the sharpness had already gone. He himself also very much tired. So somebody said, it is long time since you are working with this saw and you have been working very hard. Why don't you take a little rest and sharpen the saw and start work again? Then what did the woodcutter reply? He gave the same reply which we give when we are told to carry out spiritual practices or to read the books, holy books, or go for satsang. We give the same answer, and that answer was given by the woodcutter. What did he say? He said, what you said is very true. I am also tired, but where is the time? You know, there is so much wood still to be cut. So there is no time for me to take rest. You fool, if you take a little rest, sharpen the saw, you'll be able to finish your job much quicker, much earlier, much better. But this is what is done. This is the story of all of us, that we are so much busy in our activities that we do not get time for our spiritual practices, and then we say, where is the time? But we forget that if we perform our spiritual practices, we will be able to finish our job more quickly. When I tell the students to go for meditation, regular meditation, they say, yes, what you said is okay, but where is the time? Then I give the benefits and all that and say, okay, the students ask, tell me, okay, let us know how much time we have to give to you. As if they are obliging me. I said, minus 90 minutes. I don't have 90 minutes. I said, minus 90 minutes. What is minus 90 minutes? If you give me 15 minutes morning and 15 minutes evening, if you carry out meditation as per my instruction, what will happen? if you go for meditation both morning and evening, gradually you will have more concentration of mind, and 4 hour study will be finished within 2 hours. So how much you have given me? 30 minutes. How much I have given you? 120 minutes. So what is the net profit? 90 minutes. So you have to give me minus 90 minutes. That means I will give you 90 minutes if you meditate regularly. So we forget. We do not get time for our spiritual practices because we do not know its importance, that it is going to solve our problem of time if we give little time to spiritual practices. So what is time actually? Time is a relative term. It is always relative, and it is called according to Einstein. Both time and space are relative. And we can say, we can very well feel, we experience also, when some person is suffering from corona, positive has come, and he has shown positive, the report has shown positive, he has been quarantined for 14 days. 14 days is like 14 years of exile. And then when you are on a leisure trip on picnic for 3 days, 3 days like a 3 minutes, 3 hours. So it is, the time is relative. It depends upon your feeling. But our aim through spiritual practice is to go beyond time, space and position, which is called the absolute. The absolute is beyond time, space and position. The time, space and position are within Maya. We have to go beyond Maya, as Swami Vivekananda says in his book, Gyan Yoga. So time is a period between two events. For example, our life, the lifetime, what is it? It is the time gap between our birth and death. So this is the time that we have got, and this time we have to utilize properly. So time management will mean two things. Number one, managing the time that is given to us, which is between our birth and death, the whole life that is given to us. That is the only time. And no one knows how much time is left, because this much is true. Whosoever is born will die. But when will he die or she will die? Nothing is certain. Most certain thing in the world is death. Most uncertain thing in the world is the time of death. So we do not know how much time is left behind for us. But whatever is left there, whatever is there, let us try to make full, let us try to utilize it fully, as much as possible, because we do not know whether we get the next day or not. Fortunately, we have got a human birth. Fortunately, we have got some aspiration to go beyond time, space and position, get liberation. Fortunately, we have also got the protection of the holy persons. We are so fortunate. So let us try to explore. Let us try to make use of that great opportunity that is given to us. As Adi Shankaracharya says, Durlabham evam etatrayam devanugraha hetukam manushyattam mukshattam mahapurusha sanshaya. These three things are very, very rare, and they are obtained only by the grace of God, by the grace of the divine. What are the three things? Number one, human birth. Second, the desire of emancipation, desire of getting free, the desire of liberation. And the third thing is the company of holy persons, the grace of the holy persons. So most of us have got all the three. Now it depends upon us how we utilize this opportunity. It is here that we now get the importance of time, the importance of spiritual practice, utilizing each and every second for our spiritual practice. The time and tide wait for none, there is a proverb. Time and tide wait for none. There was a film called Time Machine, based on the novel of H.G. Wells, but it was a novel only. There is no way by which we can ride the time machine and go back into the history. No, it's not possible. In India now it is 9:06 p.m. 9:06 p.m. according to Indian Standard Time of 16th of July 2021 will never come again. Never. Gone is gone. Time can never come back. So it is irreversible. Time and tide wait for none. Another proverb, time is money. No, it is wrong. Time is not money. Time is more than money. Why? If you lose some money in your business, you can get it back. But you can't back the time that you have spent. Gone is gone. There was a beautiful write-up long many years back in Reader's Digest where it talked about a typical bank which deposited 86,400 rupees in your bank account. But the condition was that whatever money you do not utilize cannot be carried forward, it is gone. So what we will try to do, we will try to utilize each and every rupee because it cannot be carried forward. So why not utilize it? So this is the, and then Reader's Digest said, yes, this is time deposit. Every day in our account, 86,400 seconds are deposited. Everybody gets the same 24 hours, 86,400 seconds. Everybody, Swami Vivekananda got the same number of seconds per day, 86,400. We also get the same. Any great personality, same number of seconds, 86,400 seconds. With that time, 24 hours at their disposal, they carried out this great work. So, utilize each and every second. So, Swami Brahmananji Maharaj says in his book, The Eternal Companion, the time is flying. Make use of each and every moment. The time that is gone will never come back. He says there in the book. Same thing. Time and tide wait for none. Time is flying. Try to utilize each and every second. 86,400 seconds are deposited in our account. Let us try to utilize each and every second. The time that is wasted will never come back. Let us try to utilize each and every second. According to social scientists, they have made a survey that supposing the average age is 70 years of a human being. Previously it was 100 years. But now lifespan, we can say, is about 70 years. Now taking the lifespan as 70 years, for example, but that is no guarantee that everybody will live up to 70 years. No guarantee. But anyway, supposing if you live up to 70 years, then they say out of these 70 years, 28 years are spent on sleeping. 28 years sleeping. 10 years in study, 8 years in recreation, 6 years illness, 5 years traveling. Well, persons like me, time will be much more. I have been traveling. Now, fortunately, during this lockdown period, it's a blessing for me, blessing in disguise for me that no travel, and so all everything online. Then, eating 4 years. Dressing 3 years, of course it will change with the person's work 6 years. So only 6 years of work in whole lifetime. I do not have any figure for spiritual practice. I think even not 1 year it will be. The amount of time we are giving for our spiritual practices in 80 out of 86,400 seconds. How many seconds we are giving per day? So, if we are giving 10% of our time, then 7 years. But if we are giving 1 year, then not even, if we are giving every day. One, that is 86,400 seconds. We are giving 10% of our time, then it will be 10% of the whole life. It will be 7 years. But if we are giving 1% of our time, 864 seconds, that is about 15 minutes. This is the maximum an average person gives for spiritual practice. Some do not give even 2 minutes also, but 14.5 minutes, 864 seconds. That is only 1% of our time most of us are giving for spiritual practices. So that means only 1% of our life. That is, we are not living even for 1 year is not going for spiritual practice. Out of 70 years, not even 1 year we are giving to spiritual practices. So this we have to remember, how much less time is available for spiritual practices and how much now is left of life. After that, only 1% time is available for spiritual practice. So we can imagine how time is running fast and how we are coming close to the end of the game. Then we have to utilize each and every second of the present. Why? Yesterday is history, tomorrow is mystery, and today is a gift, and that is why it is called present. Then some people say, yesterday is a cancel check, tomorrow is a promissory note, and today is the cash. So there is the cash wisely. And then they say, if you want to know the importance of time, ask a student who has failed in examination and has wasted 1 year. If you want to know the time, importance of time of 1 month, then ask a lady who had a premature birth because of 1 month. If you want to know the importance of 1 week, ask the editor of a weekly who has to every week bring out this weekly. If you want to know the importance of a day, then ask the businessman who was late in giving his tender, submitting his tender only by 1 day, he missed it. If you want to know the importance of 1 hour, then just wait, just see the mother waiting for her child to return from the school. Then if you want to know the importance of 1 minute, then you ask the person who missed the train by 1 minute. If you want to know the importance of a second, you ask the person who was saved from accident just by a fraction of a second. And if you want to know the importance of a millisecond, you ask the person, the athlete, who missed the gold medal just by 1 millisecond. So, time is very, very important. And particularly for the spiritual aspirants. Why? Because spiritual aspirants want to achieve the goal of life, that is freedom, God-realization, self-realization, whatever you call, within this lifetime. And this lifetime is very short. It's a very short span. So that is why we have to utilize each and every second. We have to be very, very cautious that we do not waste our time. And what is spiritual life? So Swami Vivekananda has beautifully summarized the whole gamut about spiritual life, the gist of Vedanta, in his book on Raj Yoga. Each soul is potentially divine. The goal of human life is to manifest this divinity within by controlling nature, external and internal. Do this either by work or worship, or psychic control or philosophy. By one or more or all of these, and be free. This is the whole of religion. Doctrines, dogmas, rituals, temples, churches, mosques are but secondary details. So this practicing the four yogas, Raj Yoga, meditation, Bhakti Yoga, prayer, Gyan Yoga, reflection on our true nature, and Karma Yoga, unselfish service, work without attachment. These four yogas, we try to practice these spiritual practices consisting of practicing these four yogas that will lead us to the ultimate goal, going beyond time. So we have to utilize each and every second, we have to utilize time so that we can go beyond time. In this very life, we can achieve our target. And this can be done in two ways. Number one, increasing time for spiritual practices gradually to the extent possible. To the extent it is allowed under the circumstances in which we are placed. Suppose you have to go to the office, you are working very hard. Naturally, there will be less time. But on Sundays, on weekends, maybe you can give a little more time. Then, but that is not enough. Because spirituality is not only meditating morning, evening, 15 minutes. Spirituality is ritualizing the whole life. That is converting work into worship by proper attitude of mind. This is very important because every one of us will have to work. And just now as we just went through the analysis, very little time we are giving for spiritual practices out of 86,400 seconds. Maximum time is going next to sleeping and eating and all that, our regular activities, which are unproductive at the same time unavoidable. After that, most of our time is going for some work. If you are an officer, you are going to the office. You are a businessman, you are going to business. If you are a housewife, you are cooking and washing and all that. So, unless until we know the art of converting work into worship, we will not be able to utilize our time properly. So, this also has to be taken into account that managing time for spiritual practices does not mean only taking out more time for spiritual practices, at the same time converting work into worship. Each and every activity to be converted into worship. Each and every activity should be taken as a part of spiritual practices. This is very important. So, coming to time management, normal techniques, we will just go to the ABCD, that's all. ABCD. A is analyze. First, analyze. Analyze is very important. Analyze your life, analyze yourself. How much time we are wasting? How much time we are carrying out productive work? How much time we are doing? How much time we are spending for spiritual practices? Number one. How much time we are utilizing for productive activities or essential activities, necessary activities? And how much time we are spending, not spending, wasting uselessly. So make a chart. We can make a chart. Number one, in the whole day, let us try to analyze at the end of the day, during the whole day. And supposing if we want to plan for future, then first, what we should do is urgent and important work should be taken up. Allot time. First importance time is important. First slot is for important and urgent work. Second, important but not urgent. Third, urgent but not important. Fourth, neither important nor urgent. This should be the priority. First priority, give the priority to the activities urgent, important. normally what we do after urgent and important, we go for urgent, urgent, urgent only, and the whole day is spent only in urgent, and the important activity like spiritual practice, it is sidelined. No, the second step would be, of course, first will be urgent and important. If there is a fire, we cannot say that at present my important activity is spiritual practice, let me meditate and let the fire go on, afterwards I will do. We can't do that. So we have to go for most important thing is, first thing is first priority, urgent and important. Second priority should be important but not urgent. Third should be urgent but not important. And fourth should be neither urgent nor important. So we analyze our activity like that, then we will find we are getting a lot of time, because the fourth activity, that is neither urgent nor important, is taking away a lot of our time. Like gossiping, chatting or WhatsApp chatting. So many, nowadays we have so many digressions, particularly gadgets. So a lot of time is being wasted. Not productive at all. Neither it is required, neither it is giving you, neither you are able to earn money out of it, nor you are able to earn the spiritual benefit out of it. So we can eliminate those activities which are completely non-productive, which has got nothing to do with spiritual practices. Let us try to eliminate those items, to analyze and then eliminate. This, if we can do that, we will be able to get more time for spiritual practices. B is bite as much as you can chew. Bite as much as you can, as you can chew. Otherwise, what happens? You bite too much, then you are not able to chew. The mouth is full. So it is taking a long time. You are in difficulty, the food is not chewed properly and it creates problems in the stomach. So what we have to do? Bite as much as you can chew. Meaning, take up as much work as can be conveniently performed by you. Many people are so ambitious, they want to do so many things at the same time. Riding not only in 2 horses, 10 horses, and then falling down. Natural, they will fall down. If you ride on 10 horses simultaneously, you can do more and more work, but one by one, one after another. But simultaneously, if you try to do, well, there is something, some multitasking can be done. But this is, I am not talking about that multitasking, this small, small activity. But I am talking about you have got your own business, then you go for another side business, then you go for another side business, go on expanding and not concentrating or not focusing on the main business. Or you got this particular thing, then you got that hobby also, then that hobby also, you are not able to concentrate and go on increasing, spending time restlessly. This is what I am meaning. So if we can check that one, bite as much as you can chew. I had the blessed privilege of serving Swami Kailashananji Maharaj, who was the vice president of the Ramakrishna Order. So he used to tell me, he was from East Bengal, so he used to say, "Taas badhaiyo na, taas badhaiyo na." Don't increase work unnecessarily. So I was his sevak, so I thought, other sevaks of other vice president Maharaj, and they are, you know, washing the clothes and ironing it. So I will also wash, after washing the clothes, I will iron it. Then Maharaj used to say, "Why you are ironing it? Don't waste time. Kaas bada hi hona. Don't increase time. Don't waste, don't increase the work." So then in order to teach me a lesson, what he will do, deliberately he will do like that, all the clothes. So meaning thereby that all your effort has gone, all your time is gone. So don't go for ironing the clothes. Anyway, that, and he used to spend lot of time in Japan, lot of time. And he would sit in the inside the Garba Mandir, whether he was in Madras Mutt, Chennai, or whether it was Belu Mutt. I saw most long hours he would spend in doing Japam. So that is what he used to say, Kas Badayona, do not increase unnecessary work, bite as much as you can chew. C is combine the activities wherever possible. So sometimes some activities can be combined easily. For example, you are cooking. Now we have put some things on the cooker. You are not cooking. The cooker is cooking the things. At that time, you can either dress vegetables, or you can listen to music, you can listen to discourses. So many things you can do, or simultaneously you can do a cooking work itself. We can combine 3-4 activities. And along with cooking, you can also do some reading, or somebody will read out and you will listen, or you put on a CD and listen to the lectures, satsang. Of course, many of us are already doing it. And supposing you are traveling. So while traveling, you can listen to music, you can listen to the devotional song, you can listen to discourses on YouTube. You can, if not YouTube, some devotees, they told me the YouTube, it becomes difficult in the car. So I gave them the pen drive containing my lectures. Now very, very happy. Just put the pen drive. They, every day they have to travel 2-3 hours. So 2 lectures while going and 2 lectures while returning, they are listening. So combining the work. You can combine repetition of the mantra. You can, or listening to music, but don't meditate while driving. that will be disastrous. But you can perform mental japam at the time of driving, or listen to music, or listen to discourses. That can be done. So there are many activities where you can combine your spiritual practices along with that work. This is how we can get time, more time for our spiritual practices, or we can increase the quantum of our spiritual practices, at the same time converting work into worship. Apart from that, converting work into worship, also the traditional spiritual practice also can be increased by combining these activities. So C is combine. D is discipline. Discipline is very important in spiritual practice. Swami Virjananji Maharaj says that it will be nice for spiritual aspirants to have a fixed routine. That helps a lot. Once you've got a fixed routine, your time requirement will be less. Why? You know, supposing every day you are meditating at 5 a.m. What happens? After a few days, the mind gets habituated to sit for meditation. Every day, you are taking lunch at 12 o'clock. So the mind gets habituated to take lunch at 12 o'clock. So once it becomes a habit, what happens? You don't need settling down time. You know, when the cricket players, when the batsman, when he starts his batting, he has to settle down. Similarly, he has to watch the bat falling. So similarly, when you meditate, the mind goes here and there, wanders. So it requires settling down time. But if you are sitting for meditation every day at the appointed time, the mind is automatically attuned. It knows, the mind knows that this is the time when I have to go for meditation. This is the time I have to go for lunch. This is the time I have to go for exercise, physical exercise. So everything, if we can have a routine. Some people say that, oh, if we go for routine, it becomes monotonous. Well, if you want to avoid monotony, you can have a separate routine for Sundays and holidays. Not only that, at least for certain activity, certain important activity, at least I am talking about the spiritual aspirant, at least your spiritual practice, there should be fixed time for spiritual practice. Other items, you may go, you go for flexibility. But at least our time of spiritual practices, they should be fixed. And preferably, Brahma Muhurta is the best Muhurta for spiritual practices. Sri Ramakrishna said, that time my mind is attuned with the Virata, with the cosmos. And so there are spiritual vibrations in the cosmos at that time. It becomes easier to concentrate and to meditate. So, Brahma Muhurta. So, about 1 hour before sunrise. That will be an ideal time. If you can't do that, then as soon as you have got up, whatever time you get up, immediately after getting up, just little washing and you can sit for meditation. Not that you get up and then read the newspaper and then take bath and everything. And then you sit for meditation. By the time the mind is already polluted. So during meditation, all those things will come. So there should be clean slate. That is immediately after getting up from your sleep. Better to start your meditation early morning. And then again in the evening. If evening is not possible because of your work, you are coming late from your office, then you can do it at night. No problem. But at least 2 times we have to give some time to spiritual practices. So let us have a routine. In our ashramas, we have a routine. 5 o'clock, there is a conch shell, then there is a Mangalarti, then all the monastic brothers, they sit down for meditation. Then afterwards, there is Gita chanting or something of the Vedic chanting and all that. Then there is 7 o'clock, there is breakfast. Then there is a class or something like that. And then there is those people who have got their duties in library or hospital or in school or in office. They will go to their respective places of work, work as worship. And then again, come back 12 o'clock. There will be lunch. The bell will go. For everything, there is a bell. For breakfast, the bell goes. For lunch, the bell goes. So what happens? Sometimes when we are outside, at 12 o'clock, the bell goes. I am now outside. I am not in the ashrama. The bell is there in the ashrama, ringing in the ashrama. It rings in my stomach also. I have to tell, no. This is not ashrama. Here you will get food. Afterwards, now give lecture. So, anyway, but the mind becomes habituated at morning 5 o'clock, I have to meditate. 12 o'clock noon, I have to take lunch. So, it becomes easier because of the habit. So, this routine helps a lot. If we cannot be very perfect, at least try to do as much as possible. I had the privilege of seeing Swami Gambhirananji Maharaj. He later on became the 11th president of the Ramakrishna Order. When he was vice president, at the time he was in Ranchi and I was on Ranchi. So I had at the time observed, earlier also when I joined in 1976, that time he was general secretary, that time also I saw what a fixed routine. And every minute is accounted for in his life. If he is sit down for lunch, this is the time, it's 12 o'clock. If he gets up after the rest, if he gets up at 2, it's 2 o'clock. 2:15 reading, then 2:15 reading. Seeing the files, correspondence at 3:15, it will be 3:15 only. going for walk at 6:15 morning, it will be 6:15 only. So I had the privilege of going on a walk every day with him. One day I saw that he has gone a little before time. So I had to run and rush after him. And I was thinking that why he started 2 minutes early. Then later on I found out my watch was 2 minutes late. His watch was perfect. You can correct your watch by the movements of revered Gambhiranji Maharaj. So much. And when you were talking about Gambhiranji Maharaj, I remember one incident. When I had joined just recently, newly I had joined at Belur Math as a brahmachari, just a pre-probationer. But I had the audacity and I had the courage. I heard that Revered Maharaj got some problem in the eyes. Every day noon, somebody reads out the books to him. So I took the courage and asked Maharaj that I would be very happy to read out some book to you. Everyone looked at me. Also surprised, this fellow has joined just few days back and he has got so much courage, because Gambhiranji's name was Gambhiranji. Gambhiranji, Gambhir means serious. Really, he deserved that name. Very serious. Nobody dared talk to him. And also he was general secretary. Everybody was afraid. But I went and asked. He said, okay, come from tomorrow. 2:15, give me the time. So every day I would go at 2:15. Just 2:15 he will open his door upstairs in his old headquarter building, just opposite the temple. He used to stay upstairs. He will open his door and I'll enter and he will indicate me. I could sit down. So I will sit down in the chair opposite to his chair, opposite the table. And then he would give me every day he will take out the book and there he will give the mark also what I have to read. So many books will come to him for his opinion, review, this and that. So it will be on his table. He'll put that table, give that book to me. And I'll read exactly 10 minutes. Then I'll just do my pranam and then leave. This went on for a few days very nicely. One day it so happened, it was hot, very hot, the summer days, and I was perspiring, whatever it is, night, I could not sleep. There was no fan at the time in Belur Math. Talking about 76, so noon, somehow or the other, after lunch, I got a little nap. And by the time I got up, it was already 2:50. So immediately I washed my face and brushed. I went there. Door is already open. He has opened the door exactly 2:15. And I am not there outside sitting in the bench. So then I went there inside. I went around to him and sat down on the chair opposite to him. He did not say a single word. What he did, you know, there was a small table clock which was facing him so that he can see the time. What he did, he just turned the table watch towards me. That's all. He did not say anything, telling me as if that this is how much you are late. I was so much ashamed, and then I apologized. And then from next day, no nap, nothing. From 1 o'clock itself, I would be sitting outside the bench, outside his room. Anyway, so he was so much, very much disciplinarian, very much disciplinarian, and time, this punctuality. But we must remember, the time management is not punctuality, it is good. Punctuality is a must, but simply punctuality is not time management. Time management is the productive use of our time in such a manner that we get more time for our spiritual practice, in such a manner that all our activities are converted into spiritual practices. This we have to remember. For a spiritual aspirant, of course, the one first step is this one, is we have to maintain time. Punctuality is a must, but that is not enough. That is only a small part of the time management. This is also necessary. In India particularly, we have to learn the lesson from the Western countries like yours. In your country, in Canada, in Japan, still more, so much conscious of time, so much of punctuality, unlike in India. Swami Ranganathanji was there. He later on became the 13th president of our Ramakrishna Order. He used to go on tours abroad. Any world tours he has done, was a very, very popular orator speaker. So he was almost like officially cultural ambassador of India. So he had many friends in all the countries. He had a friend in Japan. When that friend had come to India, he asked Swamiji, Swami Ranganathanji, one thing I am noting here. We are producing so many watches, but still we do not consume so much. We have one watch for family. And here you are not producing so much. And I'm talking about 30 years back. That time our production was not that much. Now we are producing so many watches. And still I find everybody wearing a watch. Not only that, even a cycle rickshaw puller, even he is wearing a watch. If you ask the time, he said, you just see, dekh lijiye babu, just see. He doesn't know how to see the time. And then that Japanese friend told Ranganathanji Maharaj, and the paradox is that everybody wearing the watch and nobody keeping time. So that is our Indian, even sometimes they sarcastically say also Indian standard time. Indian standard time means minimum half an hour late. And there is a joke also that there was one train. One day, those times, now the situation is much better. Even if the train comes, it is 5-10 minutes late. But that time, many years back, trains used to be late. So one day the train came in time. What is the matter? The train right in time. So yesterday's train is only 24 hours late. Anyway, so this punctuality is very much desirable. In Western countries, Indians will have to learn from the Western countries. So I was talking about discipline. So the disciplined mode of life, the routine, if we can have the routine, that would be very nice. A, B, C, D, I'll confine myself to this four. A, analyze how much time we are wasting, how much time we are utilizing properly, how much time we are giving to spiritual practices, how much time we are wasting, and try to eliminate those activities which are non-productive, and analyze the activities, make it into four divisions, urgent and important, difference number one, important, not urgent, number two, urgent, not important, number three, and number four, neither urgent nor important. If we can have this analysis and we can try to go for this based on these preferences, if we can go for the managing the time, I think the spiritual aspirants will be able to get little more time. By the utilization of this time properly, we will be able to get more time for our spiritual practices. Most important, as I told you again and again, trying to remember the importance of time for spiritual aspirants. For everybody, time is very, very important. But for spiritual aspirants, much more important. Why? Because in one lifetime, we want to go beyond time. In one lifetime, we want to realize God. Very limited time during which we have to reach the Absolute. which is beyond time, space and position. Time is very short, so we have to utilize the time correctly, properly, and in a manner so that we do not waste even a single second out of 86,400 seconds that are deposited in our account every day morning. Tulsidas, Goswami Tulsidas, was a great saint in India. He used to say in Hindi, "Kal kare so aaj kar, aaj kare so ab, palmay palle hoigi, bohri karego kab." Whatever you want to do yesterday, you do it today. Whatever you want to do today, you do it now. Just now. Now is the time. Now, N-O-W. This word is very important. Now, now, now. Now or never. This principle, if you follow, now. I have to do, if it is a good thing, now. If it is a not good thing, then postpone it. Not now. But if it is a good thing, it is a commendable thing, it is related to spiritual practice, yes, now. Kal kare so aaj kar, aaj kare so ab, palmay parlay hoegi, bohri karego kab. When will you do that work? Any moment, the whole thing can be destroyed, the life can be destroyed. Then, aache din paache gaye, harise kiya na het, ab pashtawa hot kya, jab chidiya chugbe khet. What a beautiful thing. Aache din paache gaye. The days are going, going, going. Every day, time is passing, days are going. But we did not love the Lord. When will we love the Lord? The days are passing. When a time will come, ab pashtawa hot kya, jab chidiya chug gayi khet. A time will come when we have to repent. There is no point in repenting when the birds have already eaten away the whole crops. Similarly, when the life has taken away all the seconds that are available with us, now we don't have any time. Afterwards, it is no regret. Oh, I want little more time to meditate. I little want little more time to do study. I little want time to read the books. If I get little more time, no. It's no use repenting afterwards. Then, do baatan ko bhool mat, jo chahe kalyan, narayanik mot ko duje shiv. If you want your welfare, then do not forget two things. What is that? What are the two things? That is, one is death. Second, God. Now, it is easy during this corona pandemic to remember death, because every day, everywhere there is death. Every day there is death. Death, death, death everywhere. They say the third wave will be still more dangerous. More the first wave, second wave are more dangerous than first wave. And third is maybe going still more dangerous than the second wave. Dark death all around. So the positive thing is that let us take a lesson out of it, that death can come to me also. And it will be all over. Before death comes, let us play our game. Before death comes, let us conquer the death. Before death comes, let us utilize the time in such a manner that we can go beyond time and space and causation and reach the absolute. So this is very important, that we go on striving as a spiritual aspirant. And one saint said very nicely, start every day as if it is the first day of your initiation and last day of your earthly existence. First day of your initiation, the last day of your earthly existence. You know, when we get initiation, we get mantra diksha, when we start our spiritual life, oh, how much enthusiasm is there. Gradually the enthusiasm goes down, 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 down. So always have the enthusiasm the first day as far as spiritual practice is concerned. Remember, it is the first day of spiritual life. And remember, it's the last day of your earthly life. This death can come. Think that today is the last day. Then what happens? So many unnecessary things. My God, today is the last day. Let me do. Because most important thing is that to take the name of the Lord before death. This is very important. So that is why we automatically, we will be, the whole life will come round and we'll be able to reach our goal. So Swami Vivekananda says, arise, awake and stop not till the goal is reached. What is the goal? Goal is to reach the absolute. Goal is to go beyond time, space and position. And if we really want to go beyond time, space and position, we have to utilize each and every second. We have to utilize the time properly. Then we'll be able to reach. So I pray to Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna Dev, Ma Sharada Devi and Swami Vivekananda. May they bless us all. May we be able to follow their instruction, utilize the time properly and carry out our spiritual practices and achieve the goal of life. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Tassat. Sri Ramakrishna Paramastu.